Hallelujah. Glory and power forever and ever. Amen. You know, God is worthy of praise. Seems like such a basic statement, and we know it in our heads, but sometimes we forget to really get it into our hearts. Not just on Sunday morning, but Monday morning and Monday evening, God is worthy of praise. I was blessed this morning as I was handed a note as I came in that yesterday, September 23, was 11 years since the first service at this location here in Sugar Creek. I believe the Lord deserves a hand clap for his faithfulness for these 11 years. Let's give the Lord a round of praise, right? Amen. Amen. And in those 11 years, what God has done. You know, we can look at the difficult things that have happened in those 11 years. We can look at the incredible things that have happened in those 11 years. But through it all, one thing has remained the same, and that is that God is faithful. That his promises never fail, and that he who has begun a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. Some of those who were here at that time when that first service happened are no longer here, and others have come. And God is, in his faithfulness and his mercy, has continued to speak, to bring us back, to move us forward. You know, October of 2012, the first feast, the first conference was here. And we're looking forward to a conference coming up. I was here at that first feast. And then we left from here, and in December, we moved to Saskatchewan. So we had 9 years up north as God was doing things here in Sugar Creek, here in Holmes County, here in Tuscarawas. But God has been doing a mighty work, and I just think it's so important that we remember his faithfulness. If we look back over 11 years for any of our lives, what has God done? So powerful to remember his faithfulness. And so this morning, it's with great pleasure that I, and great awe that I welcome all of you here this morning in Jesus' name. Jesus. Jesus. Say it with me this morning. Jesus. That name that is above every other name. I remember Pastor Wayne saying back in the days when we would go to Leaders Alive conference, I'd hear him, some point in the conference, would say, there's so much ministry in Jesus. In fact, all of the ministry is in Jesus, isn't it? So last week, Pastor Wayne announced that the new member orientation meetings, that's where Pastor Wayne speaks, and to those who are new to the congregation in the past year, and reflects and teaches some of the foundational principles that have been a part of the culture of Oasis, that have been a part of what God has done here. And he teaches those we try to do that every year. And because of the busyness, he mentioned last week that those would be postponed. The new dates for those, if you want to mark those down, are January 3, 10, and 17 in 2024. So we will be doing those. Most often those happen over here in the gathering room. And so if you are new to the congregation in this past year, and some of you may say, well, I'm not new in the past year, but I'd like a refresher. Well, it is a smaller group that we try to do these teachings with, but if you really want to come, contact us and we'll see if there is room in there, and maybe we'll have to make room. But anyway, January 3, 10, and 17 of 24. Also, there was a bit of confusion regarding the cancellation. Which members meeting were we talking about? The members meeting is still on for October 3, Tuesday, October 3 at 7 p.m. So this is for members and those who applied for and been approved for membership. And if you've applied for membership, you'll be getting a notice sometime here in the near future how to prepare for this members meeting. And we would like for you to be there. Also, foyer renovations. We talked about this before, but they are scheduled for the week of October 2 to 6. So next week, there will be some upheaval out front. And in fact, for our members meeting, you'll probably come into a very bare-looking foyer. Don't be surprised by that. We'll try to have it relatively clean. But at any rate, that's happening next week, so there will be a lot of things going on. Keep that in mind as you visit. And also, let's just continue to pray for Jeremiah Schmucker and the Schmucker family today. May the Lord grant his mercies and grace to them through this time. And then be in prayer for the upcoming fall conference. That is just around the corner, and there's a lot to be done before that comes, and there's a lot to be done through that week. Starting next week on Wednesday, October 4, and also the following week on Wednesday, October 11, from 6 to 8, my wife Karen and I will be here, and we're just going to simply make the church open to those who want to come and pray for a time on the premises on those evenings to pray for the conference. So you're not obligated to be here, but we're going to open the church that evening for those who want to come and pray together for the upcoming conference. And we'll have more information when you arrive as to where we will be praying and that type of thing. So pray for our speakers. If you're not able to be here for those times, but even now, begin praying for our speakers and special guests as they travel in for this conference. A very special prayer request for our dear brother John, who is working at getting a visa to come and has been having some difficulty with that. Pray and lift brother John to the Lord and the whole process of visa and travel documents for him. Pray for the anointing of God to be upon those speakers as they prepare their hearts and minds to hear from the Lord. Pray for the worship leaders and the music team as they prepare to learn new songs and learn new songs to share at the conference. Pray for the food ministry team as they prepare the food and set up for this. Pray for all the preparations being made by the various groups of volunteers that make hosting a conference possible. And let's also remember to pray for each other, that our hearts will be soft to hear the voice of God and to live in the light of his presence. I'd like to dismiss the children and teachers for Sunday school at this time. May God bless you all as you go and as you learn about God and his kingdom. And then for those of us who are in the sanctuary, I want to read a passage of scripture out of 1 Corinthians 15 as it's not really, it is a call to worship. Not in the typical sense, but as a call to worship this morning, because there's a lot of things going on in our world today. If you watch the news, if you watch or you get updates on social media from various parts of the world, you're going to see that things are shaking. Earthquakes and wars and conflicts. But this is what 1 Corinthians 15 says. Now this I say, brethren, verse 50. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this incorruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? And O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Would you stand with me this morning and let's pray together? Pastor Wayne reminded us last week to pray, and as we pray, to promote what we've been praying. I'm going to ask us this morning to pray together aloud for what God has placed on our hearts. And let's ask and invite Him to do what He is laying on your hearts this morning. Before we begin to pray, we're going to take just a moment of silence, and I want to just encourage each of you to say, Lord Jesus, what do you want me to pray for? What is on your heart? And when you've heard from Him, then let us pray together, lifting holy hands without wrath, without doubting. Lord God, I pray this morning that in this place, as we lift our voices together, Lord, you would be praised and glorified, and you would be honored because of your great name. Father, in this place this morning that you have said should be a house of prayer, may our hearts reflect to you what you have placed upon them. Father, may there be an anointing of grace in this place, that your will could be done freely, without hindrance, without the hindrance of unbelief, without the hindrance of victimhood, without the hindrance of sorrowfulness. But Lord, that you would bring an oil of joy for mourning and a garment of praise instead of the spirit of heaviness. Father, that you would shake off these things this morning, that the wind of your spirit would blow through in this place, and that you would be glorified, and that you would be magnified and lifted up. Lord, that your kingdom would come, and your will would be done on earth today as it is in heaven. May you be glorified in our midst. Oh God, may you be glorified from our hearts. May there be no idol in this heart of mine. May there be no distraction in this spirit that would take away from your work. Father, may there be no bitterness or unforgiveness that would hinder your flowing through me to touch my brothers and sisters this morning. May my pride be swallowed up in humility as I stand before your throne and I see your greatness and your glory. Father, would you move our hearts to softness before you this morning? May there be a breaking up of the fallow ground. May there be an anointing of peace where there has been anxiety. May there be a desperation for you, Lord, that turns our hearts and our throats with thirst for righteousness. Because you have said those who hunger and thirst for righteousness are blessed because they will be filled. And we look for your filling this morning. We look for your grace. We look for you, Lord. We look for you. And Father, this morning, we lift up those who are sick, those who are hurting, those who have been bound by disease, those who have been wounded by accidents. Father, I lift Jeremiah to you this morning, and I pray, oh God, that you would pour upon him your healing touch, that you would speak into the heart of the Schmucker family this morning and bring courage and strength and grace, that you would strengthen their physical bodies. Father, that you would bring healing to relationships. And Father, that you would bring a peace and a wholeness to them. Father, for the marriages this morning in this church that are struggling. God, for those who are hurting in their relationship and who don't really like each other, I pray this morning that the love of God would be shed in a new way upon hearts. Oh, Jesus, may that deep love, oh God, may it be poured abroad. May it be focused deep. May it bring unity to homes. Father, for those children that are wandering from truth this morning, and for the parents whose hearts are crying in desperation, I pray, God, oh Lord, that you would cause the hearts of the parents to turn to the children and the children to their parents. Father, may there be a reunion, a restoration. Oh, God. God, for the one that's down on themselves this morning and feels like life is not worth living. Father, speak to that heart. Father, for the man or the woman who is beating themselves up this morning on the inside, saying, I can't believe you could be that stupid, or that sinful, or that foolish. Lord, would you speak to that heart this morning? Would you give them that welcome home, that return to the Father? Because there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Lord, would you pour upon us a repentance, a godly sorrow that leads to repentance today. Search our hearts, try us and know our thoughts. See if there be any wicked way in us and lead us in the way that is everlasting. And we pray this in Jesus' name for his glory. Amen. You can remain standing if you want, or you can sit through the worship time, but we encourage you to just join us in the spirit of worship this morning.
without those, what is there to believe? But if we would believe every promise, it's many times we believe the salvation part, but there's so many promises, so many truths in God's word that we don't fully believe. And it's all based on believing Him. And then it goes on and talks about if we don't believe Him, we actually make God a liar. If we don't believe the truth. And it just hit me in such a fresh way. Do I actually believe? And do I have faith that God means what He says in His word? And do I believe it to its fullest extent? Because that's where the true life of God is in that. And it also, if there's somebody here this morning that has a mountain or has a problem with overcoming the world, or might be a tiny thing and it might be a big thing in overcoming, it says in believing Him, and if we believe in Him, we are born of God. And it is in that believing and being born of God is where we overcome. And so if there's something in front of you that looks hopeless, is it one of your a personal thing, or is it whatever it is, if it looks hopeless to overcome, if we believe in God, in that believing His word is where, and being born of Him is where the overcoming victory is. So this morning, the challenge to me was, and to all of us, do we believe and do we have faith in what God says, that He and He means what He says?
Seas may roar, yet You are always the same. It's near to heaven. With blessing and with peace, working good for be seated.
It's good to be here this morning. Sorry for a little bit of delay. There's wiring up to do and taking wires off and putting others on. It's kind of how it works. Father, we thank you this morning just for the precious time that we have and the drawing together that we have during a time of worship, how we're drawn to you and to fulfill the duties that you've called us to worship you while we're here on earth. And then this worship will never cease. It will go into the heavens, into eternity, and forever. This is one thing that we will be doing. And I pray that you would help us to be worshipers of you here, not learn it there. Father, we bless you for this time together this morning. Pray that your spirit will flow from heaven out through our vessel, through this vessel, into the hearts of people. Allow to ooze out of my heart, Father, the power of your spirit, that lives could be changed, drawn to you, and moved according to your word. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. I would like to start out with the looking out of Ezekiel chapter 47. Ezekiel chapter 47, verse. We could read here a whole bunch of verses, really, and I'm constantly conscious of time when I stand here because I'm known to go long at times, but I will try to keep it interesting for you all so that it's not hard to follow. But what we have here is the title of the message is Baptism and with Fire. The baptism of the Holy Ghost comes with the baptism of fire as well, and I think many people misunderstand what this fire is. And I've been surprised that some people don't even know what the word fire means here. Well, I will say this, that if you have been baptized with the Holy Ghost, you will certainly know what this is. This is a fire that comes from the Holy Ghost, and it's the ministering of the Holy Ghost and how we minister back to heaven. And so I would like to, early on in this message, kind of set a little bit of a thought about my life when I started out as a nominal Christian for many years. I was a nominal Christian, living basically in defeat and always not really knowing that there is more to life. And I was basically thinking that as long as you can do have well and have good and nobody catches you, you're probably going to be all right. And then always ask the Lord to forgive you for everything. It was pretty much the way it was for me. Well, when I got desperate with God, he led me down a different path. And in this path, he allowed me to meet some people that I saw that had a lot more than I had. And I do believe that this has been a tremendous inspiration of me in how to go deeper with God. I also noticed that there are people that go deeper with God. There is something like this. I never heard this taught. I didn't know there was such a thing, that you can actually go deeper with God. You can go further with God. And we have this exemplified in the Old Testament. We also have it in the New Testament. And this is what I basically want to speak about today. In Ezekiel chapter 47, here we're reading about the temple. Now, we already know that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. I would like to over and over repeat that. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit now lives in us, not in the old Solomon temple that he did back then, thousands of years ago. But he lives in us as a temple of the Holy Spirit. And in that picture, I would like to bring down some similarities, because there is a verse in the New Testament that tells us we are to be and we are to exemplify that which is in heaven. All right? So this is what one of the things that God wants from us. And if I could just bring out this order for you all, that you know that you can always experience more in the kingdom of God than what you're experiencing. Just know that. For some reason, we think that, well, is there anywhere else to go? I'm satisfied with sitting in this spot the rest of my life and basically just grin and bear it and go on and just simply be defeated. Some days defeated by, I don't feel like a Christian. Next day, I think I'm a real Christian. People like this are not very far in the faith. This is not what this Christian life is about. It's not an in and out thing. It's not just enough to make it to heaven and nothing else. I was tremendously challenged to see people that God has used in dramatic fashion, dramatic ways. And me as a little Amish-born boy, never heard of anything further than this. In fact, I even thought at some point it was only my religion, only stay in that faith and that's all you'll ever get. Just make it and somehow you'll be all right. Well, God stretched me with verses in the Bible, and this is what I want to do this morning for you as well. And I also am, let me say this, that there was a time in my life that I looked to people that excel. People that excel, they go somewhere in life. You look in the sports world, I don't remember this quote. I saw it once, a quote that Tiger Woods, that we all know about, made concerning golf. And somebody asked him, how can you be so great, or how can you be doing all these things, and how can you do this that is far above the reach of many, or by far the majority? And he just looked, and I don't have this quote, but I'll tell you the meaning. Well, if you have bloody hands of hitting clubs, and bloody hands of hitting clubs, and bloody hands, and you feel like sleeping in because you're so tired, your bones are tired, you are fatigued everywhere, and you can still fight that and get up and strike and hit balls and strike and hit balls and strike and hit balls and strike and hit balls, while other people are out partying and doing their things and the things that they like, and you're still doing that, you would eventually come to a place, maybe where I'm at. And I look at those sports figures and I look what all they throw themselves into, or people that have excelled in life, they throw everything in it they have. And then I look at Christian people, and we put so little in what we have. And yet we have the greatest gift of everything. It's salvation. It's salvation that we have. And that there's a place where we can excel in that and go much further than most Christians actually go. Now, you say like this, so what are you suggesting here? I'm suggesting only what I'm about to read in Ezekiel chapter 47. If we start in verse 1, it talks about, he brought me to the door of the house. This house here is speaking about the temple. And this is, and it goes on, for time's sake, I will go to maybe about verse 3, the end of 3. It says, "And when the man that had the line in his hand went out eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits, and he brought me through the waters, and the waters were to the ankles." Now, we're talking about depths of water that are oozing out from under the temple. Okay, so he's saying this, that there is a depth of water. It starts really shallow, and it becomes bigger and bigger the further away it goes. And he measured it, again in verse 4, "And he measured 1,000 and brought to me in the waters. The waters were to the knees, and again measured 1,000 cubits and brought me through the waters where it was to the loins. Afterward, he measured 1,000, and it was a river, and I could not pass over, for the waters were risen, waters to swim in, and a river that could not be passed over. And he said unto me, Son of man, hast thou seen this? Then he brought me and caused me to return to the brink of the river." Now, we could go down through here, and there's a tremendous amount of meaning. I've got so many words that I've written here on the sides of meanings coming out of this scripture. Without going there, let's go to the New Testament verse, which is found in Hebrews. This is found in Hebrews, one of my key verses that I've used for many, many years, and it's in Hebrews 6. I've used this verse because when I saw it the first time, I have the original markings here where I marked it, and I said, "What is this? What is this?" "Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ," and some of you that know me and have been around me have heard this verse many, many times. Some of you that are somewhat new, I want you to hear it. "Leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto," notice the word, "perfection." Now, when we think of perfection, we're exemplified in the Bible, in the Old Testament, and in several places. One thing is the perfection where God dwelt was within the tabernacle. And the next place was in the temple, still in the Old Testament. Now he calls us to be the temple, where these waters ooze out from underneath us. And my question that I have to bring out this morning then is, if we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, how much water is coming up from underneath us? What is coming out from underneath us? Is it angled depth, or is it just a little trickle, or what really is? And let's be really honest with ourselves and take a firm look at our lives. Really, what is spilling over? Really, who are we? We can do a lot of drinking of water, but how much water do we really have that will go out into other people's lives and have life-changing experiences? Like when we read of men of the old and people of faith and men that we have met and will be meeting some at this coming conference. "Let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance and from dead works and a faith toward God." It's just a vicious cycle of continual repentance, repentance, repentance over the same thing. We're stuck in the mud, like a stick in the mud, we use to describe around this community. "Of the doctrine of baptisms and the laying on of hands and the resurrection of the dead and of eternal judgment." And here is the big verse. And this is a jolting verse. And I remember when I read this and I was like, God here is speaking to us, to the Hebrews, and he's saying, there is a place of perfection that we need to go to. I want to draw you to this place of perfection, exemplified in the Old Testament in the tabernacle as being the Holy of Holies, is where it was solid gold, not even refined gold in the Holy of Holies. It was solid original gold, completely purified. This is where God dwelled. In the outer court then was the holy place. There it was perfected gold. It was gold that had to be beaten and had to be placed and refined. All right, so we see a lesser degree of that same gold. And now we go to the outer court, which was only brass and wood and some silver, which is a type of judgment. And then this is what he says, go on, and this will we do if God permit. And I notice that the only way that I can go deeper with God is based on God's permission. He has to give me permission to go on. That means there's a barrier wall somewhere. There is a barrier wall of some veil or some sort that unless I can get through that, I will not go to that perfection that he is calling us to. And so with praying and God speaking to me through his word, I saw quickly where this is.
And I allowed him to deal with me in depth, to bring me to a place of this perfection that only God calls perfection and not man. There's many people, when I say perfection, we're immediately looking out of our own eyes, we're looking out of hearing from our own ears. But what God sees as perfection is a whole different picture. Because God does not look on the outside of man. We come, we're all dressed up, sometimes in formalities, sometimes maybe even religious formalities, that we have certain appearances that we esteem as being somebody that dresses this way must be a godlier person than someone that dresses this way. We have those things, and depending on what kind of persuasion you're at in your religion, you will conclude some of those things. But what God is saying is something that he's not looking at that. He's looking further into the heart, which I believe reflects also the power of God. So when we look at this thing, what is this thing that God is, what Paul is speaking to the Hebrew people, but I will refer it as what God is saying to us. Let us go on unto perfection, and this will we do if God permit. There is actually a place in our lives that God will not permit us to go further until we meet certain kinds of things. And those certain kinds of things is what I want to talk about today. Hallelujah. I'm excited about this. Now, in Luke chapter 3, verse 16, John answers and saith, saying unto them all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one that cometh after me, whose shoes I'm not worthy to untie, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Notice he doesn't separate the two. He baptizes with the Holy Ghost and then with fire. What does the word fire mean? We notice that the first physical example that we notice in the upper room of a manifestation of the Holy Spirit was actually tongues of fire that rested on the heads of the disciples. This is the first time we read about that. And we also know what happened in the upper room was the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And this is where the fire came for the first time. I don't know that we read in any recorded history in the Bible, especially not in the New Testament, that we read where the fire of God came by way of an endowment through the Holy Spirit that came on a group of people. So if you can imagine, and we could stand at the threshold of the upper room today, and we look in there, we'll see a whole group of people, of about 120 people. And in there, they're worshiping and praising God, and they have little fire tongues, little flames of fire on their heads. Now, I don't know that we have ever seen flames of fire since then like that. But I wonder how many of us have little flames of fires on our heads. I don't think it was only for there. It was for those that have been filled and baptized with the Holy Spirit. And those fires don't go out. Because the fire is not you, it's not me, it's the Holy Spirit. So what I'm talking about today is the baptism of the Holy Spirit and with fire. What is the fire about? And I think we have a kind of a wrong understanding of it. Now this is what he says then. He says, I will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Then verse 17, it says, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather wheat into the barn. But the chaff, what is chaff? He will burn with unquenchable, same word, fire. Now, the way I look at fire is the fire of the Holy Spirit. This is something that actually does a work in us. When I look at the word chaff, I look at, as I've indicated to some of you years ago already, is if I'd have a little wheat or maybe a corn, maybe a cob of corn, and we notice all the folds out around it, or a wheat, a little bit of a wheat. Maybe I'll use the wheat because it's often referred to as that. A little wheat seed here, and I see that I'll pull it right off the plant, and I have to open it to find the seed, because around it, there's a lot of protection. I want you to hear this. There's a lot of protection around this little wheat or oat. And what it is just little folds of membrane. And as long as that membrane is there, it is very difficult for disease to go in there. It's a tremendous amount of protection. And we as Christians come to places in our life that we find little protections that protects us. And they're good and they're proper. But as God deals with us even further and takes us further and deeper into his kingdom, What happens here is at some point, that chaff has to be removed. Now, if we take that chaff and leave it right on that seat, and you ladies try to bake bread with it, it's not going to work. It's just not going to work. It'll spoil quicker. You can put it through the oven. It just will not work that way because you have chaff mixed with the actual grain. And the actual grain is where the life is. It's inside that grain is where the life is. So we go through life and we use little protections. Sometimes it's religion, and it's good. It's reasonable things that will help protect us. But there comes a time, if you want to be used by God to go to that next level, if we can call it that way, those chaffs have to be pulled away from you. Those protection, those little comfort zones have to be pulled out from you. It has to be thrashed on the threshing floor. And in order to do that, they did it, and I've walked in these places over in the old land where you walk on the threshing floors. And these threshing floors, they had to press them down. They had oxen that were walking around, and that's how they thrashed it. And it got hit by the heels and by the toes of humans and cattle and whatever, all the animals that they used to thrash this. And what it did, it separated. And it looked so insecure. It looked so like all my protection that I have stood for, that I have lived for, that has protected me up until this day. You're asking to pull this away from me so I can be more useful? Yes, there's a growing stage where this seed goes through, where it needs that protection. But after the growing stage has come to completion, there's another step to it. And there's a useful stage. In the time when it's a growing stage, it's not really a useful stage. It just hangs on to its places, and there it is. But when it becomes useful, it gets stripped from that, and then gets turned into, in this case, oats or wheat, we turn it into bread. I will talk about that later on in this picture, briefly. All right? So you get a little bit the picture. He says he will burn the chaff. He will burn the things that we depended on, that felt so secure amongst us. He'll burn it with unquenchable fire. It's a fire that he lights, and we can't put it out until it has done the work that it does. Now, I want you to take a moment and walk through your life and look at the little protections that you have. Look at the little things that are so secure to you. Your husband, your wife, your job, your house, your future. Just look at all those things. Those are secure things. Is this what God is asking us after being baptized with the Holy Spirit to lay down? Absolutely. Because he wants everything. He wants the job. He wants my life. He wants my soul, my body, and my spirit. And every aspect of me is what he wants. And when we put it into his possession, this is called an offering of consecration. Where we give him everything we are, everything we were, and everything we'll ever be. This is talking about a stripping down. But it's a voluntary thing. Let's move on. John 14, verse 16, I pray the Father, and he will give you a comforter, that he may abide with you, how long? Forever. Do you know the Holy Spirit that you have today will abide with us forever? When you die, he's not gone. Forever is forever. So I ask you, the amount of the power of the Holy Spirit we have in our lives, is that all we'll ever get throughout eternity? Maybe so, I don't know. But I do know that it says here that we should pray for him that the Holy Spirit would be upon us, and the Holy Spirit will be sent to us and will abide with us forever. So eternity will not separate us from that, nor do I know if it will increase that. I do not know, because he gives not his spirit by measure, the Bible says. So I think this should concern us, that we would be full of the Holy Spirit, full and overflowing, so where there is much water coming out of our temple. This should concern us. Let's move on. 1 Corinthians 15:49, he tells us to bear the image of the heavenly. What does that look like? In order to bear the image of the heavenly, we need to take a look of what heavenly looks like. And heavenly typically is, it has to originate from heaven in order to be heavenly. And so we use this word about the temple. I believe it's one of those things that are very clear to us. And that's found then in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, starting in verse 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? So we are the temple of God. We notice that in after the Sinai covenant came to mankind, back on Mount Sinai, remember when the fire of God, we're talking about fire today, and we'll talk a lot more about fire as we go on. Remember when the fire came down on Mount Sinai? Remember that story? Can you acknowledge with an amen? Amen. Amen. Let's hear amen. You remember that story where the fire came down and swept across the Sinai mountains? You know, I have a stone here right from that. Look at this site. This was the exterior site. This is the back site. This was the exposed site. The way I understand the Bible is the fire was right there. I could come down here, and I'll walk right straight in front of me here. I could go, come down here, and I could give you this stone and tell you, look at this, the power and the fire of God actually one day touched this. This is from Mount Sinai, from over in Saudi Arabia. That is exactly. Look at the difference. You can see it's scorched. It's light. Scorched, light. And if you look at the mountaintop of Sinai, you see that the top is dark, like blackened with smoke. All right? How many of you would like to come and touch this? It'd be kind of special, wouldn't it? May I touch you? Holy Spirit is not with this, but the Holy Spirit is with you. You are much more precious than this. You have a much greater value than this. Because the Holy Spirit is actually in you if you're born again. And then if you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you have another portion on him. An outpouring like they did in the book of Acts. Makes you more special than this. Now this is quite precious. You are quite precious. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit, not this. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. But this is really something. Came from top of Mount Sinai. Hallelujah. I was over there. Let's take a look at what this temple looked like. So in the beginning, so when God gave his covenant, when this all happened, then he took the law and wrote it on tablets of stone. All right? And those are known as the Ten Commandments. So after the Ten Commandments were put in order and in place, can you see Moses? And I was there, I looked at this, where he probably came down. Moses was walking down, and then he already saw that they were violating the law and were committing idolatry by way of worshiping a golden calf. And Moses immediately took a tablet of stone. That's kind of what this looks like, a tablet. There are some of these right above Elijah's cave. About exactly this. That's where this comes from. And it was not laying on the ground. This was still part of the big rock pulled off. So, just let's look at this picture. So here we go. Moses receives the Sinai covenant. That is, God said in the first, before the flood, God said to Adam and Eve, do not eat of the fruit in the middle of the tree, the tree in the middle of the garden. But they did. So they violate, so God had to shut the door, and it was separated. Next thing we know, God said, okay, I want to come, and I will be with you again. But this time, I will give you 10 things to do and not to do. That's it, just 10. First time was one, don't eat of the tree. Next, 10 things you don't do. And right after it was given, they already violated and started worshiping a golden calf. So Moses threw the tablet down really quick, because I believe if he wouldn't have broken them, the law would have stood over him and they would have all killed. I believe that, based on some other scriptures. We won't go into those details, but what happens the next time? He said, I will walk with you, and I'll walk with you in a pillar of what? Fire. And a cloud by the day, fire by the night. And I will direct your path, I will tell you where to go, I will lead you there, but it's by fire in the night and a cloud in the day. This is how I'll do it. All right? Well, what they did is they went in a big circle. And what happened is God was actually in them, in the tabernacle that was built. God was on that mercy seat. That's where his presence was. Now, if I take a stand back and I look at the tabernacle, I'll see certain things. I see that in the holy place, there is, in the Holy of Holies, that's where God dwelt, on the Ark of the Covenant. But then there was a veil, and on the outside of the veil, there was an altar, and there was a showbread table, and then there was seven golden candlesticks. So fire touched all three of those items. Fire was there to bake the bread. Fire was there to light the candle. Fire was there for the little altar right in front of the veil. Now we go on the outside. There was a door. Now we go on the outside. Now what we have, again, is a fire that could never go out. It was on the big altar where the people that committed sins needed to come in, and there was an atonement made through the fire. So we see that when we look at the presence of God, whether it was in the tabernacle or whether it was in the temple and now in the upper room, it all had something to do with fire. What is this fire all about? Somehow, and I have verses then at the end to conclude, other places where God spoke with fire, God spoke through fire, God used fire. It was fire as a means of communication, a means of direction, a means of purifying, a means of life changing. It was done through fire that came from him. So, remember what I just read here? He tells us to bear the image of the heavenly. In the heavenlies, when we look at the book of Revelation, we see fires burning in heaven. The candlesticks were there. In Revelation, it talks about it. The seven spirits of God, it says. So we see that the veil, the temple, and the tabernacle, and now us as human beings, all have something in common concerning this fire. But what does it look like? How can we apply it even closer to us? So I go to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 20. By a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, our flesh. So there is a new veil, there's a veil somehow that we have here too. We do have a veil. The tabernacle had a veil, the temple had a veil, but when Jesus rose from the dead, and or died and rose from the dead, the veil was rent from the top to the bottom, so man did not do it. It wasn't anything that man pulled apart and now it tore open. But then he asked his children that all of them would be circumcised. Why? Because that is the flesh part, the veil part of us human beings. So we're looking at the early one, the tabernacle had a veil, the temple had a veil, and what's our veil? Do you know what our veil is? Can someone just say it? Flesh. Our veil is the flesh. Whew, what does my flesh look like? My flesh is that which I'm entwined inside of it. You see my flesh. This is what I look like. This is flesh. But my flesh has a spiritual side to it that it does fight, and that is my flesh man fights the spiritual life. My flesh man does not like to be dealt with. My flesh man likes to have his own way. My flesh man does not want to lay its life down. My flesh life has an image to bear. And that image is to make me look good, not God look good. That image, that is for something that I want for myself. I want what this flesh wants. I will do what this flesh wants. I will go where this flesh says to go. I'm in control of this man. This is called a veil. It's a spiritual veil. And that, through the Old Testament, had to be dealt with just symbolically by circumcision. Notice where circumcision actually came from. Circumcision, if we want to speak plain, it had to do with the reproductive part of a male that had to be circumcised, meaning the reproduction of what is produced out of us as human beings has to have surgery. And that surgery is the breaking of the veil. And unless we allow that to happen in our flesh, man, you will just simply walk in flesh, and you will walk a difficult life, and you will never get anywhere in the Christian life. Your life is the same mundane life on Monday as it is on Tuesday and on Wednesday and on Thursday, and you conclude the same week again by the end of the week. And I thought somebody made that statement this morning. Heard it. I think maybe it was you, John. Or was it? No, I heard it from Batania. I was listening to them this morning. Life, just life, will become complicated. Just life. If you're going to have life, and we all have life, that complicates itself. Life has nothing good to offer to us, really. It just complicates things. We run into problems, again, we're dealing with life. My life has done this. My life. Just life itself offers complication and sin and defeat. So this thing needs to be cut. It needs to be severed so it loses its strength. And in that of losing its strength is where the Holy Spirit will come in and will transform a person and take control of his life and live in his life, known as ye are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So we see the differences. We see how God deals with us from the temple, from the tabernacle to the temple, and now to us as the temple of the Holy Spirit. I was blessed some years ago, and I'm not sure which year it was, where I was over in Israel. But I was somewhere, I believe it had to do with the museum of, one of the museums that we went through where they showed a film. How that it probably looked like a reenactment of temple moments and times back in Solomon's time. And I was astounded by that. When I was over there this last time again, I tried to find that, and I don't know where it was, but I thought it was in this museum, and it wasn't there. I was astounded at the beauty and the awesomeness of what it looked like and how people would travel from many distance to come to be in the presence of that temple. One thing that it showed, there was fire burning, there was fires, and there was sanctification going on. People were sacrificing. There was activity. All kinds of activity was going on at this temple moment. But one of the things that happened that I was so blessed is they had 120 singers, sons of Asaph, I believe is what they were called. And what they were doing is they sang and sang and sang and danced before the Lord all the time. This had to go on 24 hours a day. And so when you came close to a temple, there was music. There was instruments of music. It was an enjoyable picture. It was astounding. And they were dressed in their garments, which they were commanded to wear. And I've seen some of those garments remade. It's beautiful. They were dressed in white. Can you imagine 120 people in temple, in front of a temple with torches burning and fires burning and incense burning and knowing that the power of God and God himself is actually right inside those doors in behind that veil. This is the way it looked. And so if we would know that we would come to that place and with trumpets and with shofars and other music or instruments of music and they were playing and it was tremendous jubilee and then they go back to their huts and back to their dusty path and go back and then come back a year later. Can you imagine what this would, what kind of an effect? It's almost like it would have been a revival of something new and something fresh and something to hope for. It was tremendous. I saw them, they were, as they were doing their trumpets and blasting things and beautiful singing that went on, I saw this picture. God has also given me some visions in life. And I've seen those visions, and it very much matches with those things that I saw. the absolute splendor of what it looked like when God was in Jerusalem, lived in the temple of Solomon. But one day, it all came to an end. And the people got tired of the formality. And things start to change, and the countenance of the people started falling. As people lost their interests, God was no more first. It was no more that they found hope when they go there. They got sidetracked. There were some idols along the side that they could bow to. And idolatry started raising up. And it started raising up according to what we read in Ezekiel. And one night, or one daytime, Ezekiel had this powerful vision. And as I stood there in Jerusalem and looked in through those city gates of the Eastern Gate, more than once, in fact, I have a stone that would have witnessed this, a stone that was built in the rocks, part of a big, huge rock that was not movable, that would have witnessed the very atmosphere of what I'm speaking about. And then all at once, the glory. Ezekiel dreamed about this, and he said he saw in a dream or in a vision. He saw that, in fact, I think I'll read it. Hallelujah. Ezekiel 10:18. Then the glory of the Lord departed from off the threshold of the house or the temple and stood over the cherubims, and the cherubims lifted up their wings and mounted up from the earth in thy sight, in my sight. And when they went out, the wheels also were beside them. And everyone stood at the door of the eastern gate of the Lord's house. And the glory of the God of Israel was over them above. Ezekiel 11:23. And the glory of the Lord went up from the midst of the city and stood up upon the Mount of Olives, which is on the east side of the city. Ezekiel had a vision. He saw the glory of God leave the temple and the path all the way out through the eastern gate. And then it stood over top. For it says, some days on the Mount of Olives. And the glory of God had no more place to go. It was not welcome in the temple anymore because the temple was now being overcome by idolatry and jealousy, it says. If you read the context of it, Tammuz was being worshipped. And Israel lost their interest in the power of God. It was not important to them anymore. They got sidetracked, and there's other things that happen. And the next thing you know is God will not always be available when you don't want him. So he removed himself. The glory of that, the joy and the array of his blessings and the array of the beauty of what was going on there, all at once became a daily life experience for some people, and they didn't consider it important. It lost the glory of it. The long dusty trails became too grim to walk. The sacrifices cost too much to sacrifice for some. And there were other gods that could be worshipped. And the fire went out in the temple. And God left the place, never went back. Never went back. They built other temples, but there is no scripture anywhere to support that his glory returned. But it went on top of the Mount of Olives, and there it waited. And it says there was weeping. And now I see a soul going to the Mount of Olives. I've stood at an old wine press, and I've stood and listened and even helped turn it, an old olive press. For it smashed everything. It smashed through the surface of those olives. It smashed the stone on the inside. And it looked like a miserable, horrible mess. How can something good come out of this mess? I saw it. I touched it. I didn't taste it. But it was like green mashed potatoes that had seeds in it. It was horrible. It was one of the worst looking messes that I can recall. And then it was put under a squeeze, and it was squeezed and pressed hard. All at once, a beautiful golden stream of olive oil came out of it, and it was good for the taste. It was had value in it, tremendous value. Now remember, that was the Mount of Olives. Have you been to the Mount of Olives? Maybe the crushing that is going on in your life is just simply God's crushing to make the olives into oil that flows from the Holy Spirit. Maybe there's something in the other side, something further that God is calling you to. Now I will say this, that the glory left that temple, and now we are that temple. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Every one of us in here, we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. And let's not get tired of it. Let's not get tired of God's working in our lives. Let's not get tired of trials. Let's not get tired of hard times. When God moves us and when God changes us, when He pours us from one vessel to another one, don't get tired of that. That's how it works. There's a continual working that God does in us. He presses us and He takes us further and further as the wheat chaff is falling from us and is burned with unquenchable fire. Can't even hang on to it. So what does this fire look like? The three active places of service, I want to refer it this way. It was the altar, and it was the laver, and then the place of consecration. I believe all of us that are Christians have gone past that altar, where we've laid down our sins, we've laid down our problems, and we confessed our sins, we confessed our sin, the root cause of what is causing us to sin. We've confessed that. And some of us have to confess it over and over. This is a type and shadow of the New Testament. You look at the book of Hebrews, that entire book of Hebrews is almost dedicated entirely to the types and shadows of the tabernacle. I'm going to be speaking about tabernacle. That's a teaching I want to do sometime to some of you. Not today. But the next one, we notice that in these three active places in the tabernacle, first was the altar. This is the first time we met the fire of God when He dealt with us. All right? And then the next piece of furniture in the tabernacle in the outer court was the laver, where they washed themselves. If they didn't wash themselves, they would die as they go back and forth. It was commanded in the Bible. But the place I want to speak about today, more than anything, is the place of consecration, a place where not many walk. We've asked God, we've asked Jesus to come into our lives, the cleansing of sin for salvation. And then we go on in life and we mirror ourselves in the Word of God, which is the work of the laver. But it's the next step that most people, few people, and I believe this is where the baptism of the Holy Spirit meets people's lives. It's a consecration offering. It's where you lose your identity with man or with sects or with tribes or religions or programs or anything. You lose it all. You lay it all down. Many people do not do that because they have a reputation to retain. They have an image that they cannot lay down. And you will not go further. This will we do if God permit. That's that spot. Jesus said, I am the door. It's this door that we're about to look at. We will not go past that door. And when I talk about the tabernacle, I can give you all the details of what all it stands for, how many posts and the curtains and all that. But this is what it is. It is also a place of sacrifice. But it is where they took the priests and they took their coats off. That which they looked like Levites, they were Levites because you could pick them out. They dressed like them. The different tribes, I can drive through Holmes County and I can tell you what sect of different people and tribes are in this community. Some of it based on how they dress, some of it based on what their vehicle looks like that they drive in or ride in. And you know what I'm talking about. But there comes a time when God wants to deal with all of that. And mostly that is this chaff I'm talking about. Things that were protections to you. Things that you modeled yourself at. Things that you were called. This is who I am. I've known this. I'm a kind person. I'm always, we have a certain image we want to bear. And we pride ourselves in that idolatry. Rather than focusing on allowing God to work out of us the beauty of who He is and who He has, and so that the water can flow forth from the temple, not only 1 inch deep. We are all in a different depth. This is uncomfortable. I remember when God met me at this spot. I never heard a teaching like this, never heard anything like it. God led me there. Are you willing to give up your name? Are you willing to not identify yourself with where you were born and raised in? Whew. And I was like, what will people say? Yeah. See, my reputation was attached to that. We don't like to be uncomfortable. We don't like to lay our lives down in that uncomfortable zone where God can actually take His knife and deal with us the way He chooses, not we choose. This is the consecration offering. What they did is they had to strip them all their clothes off. From there on, if this looked like Oasis, all right, you can look at me and say, oh, that's an Oasis person. Oh, that's a Baptist. That's a Mennonite of some sort. Amish. This district, that district. You can pick all that out by certain things. May I say, chaff. Really. There's certain protections. Don't blame God for not taking you deeper in life if you can't give up more than that. You will never go further. You just will not. We are not to maintain our image. We're to maintain His image. And He does that through His Spirit. And He woos us on these paths. He draws us. And if He knows in your heart whether you want to go on into perfection or the where you're content right where you're at. And many people are content right where they're at, and their Christian life doesn't work very well for them. Why am I so powerless? Because I'm not deep with God. Why does the power of God not work through me more? Exemplified. I remember the moment in time when God dealt with me and said, you know, anything that I'm doing up until now, I can pretty much contribute to still there is no God. So an atheist could look at me and say, well, you can't prove by your life that your God is alive. Oh, yeah, but you have joy. You say you do. You say you do. And I basically concluded that unless we see supernatural things coming out of us, I believe this is where God is calling us. Supernatural things. Then you know there is a God. But the rest, we can form ourselves so comfortably and fit in many different places and smile, but never go deeper with God. And what I'm speaking about today is going deeper with God. And I want to look a little bit at that yet. And we want to look at fire, what it really looks like. We notice here in Matthew chapter 7, verse 7, it talks about ask, seek, knock, and so forth. And verse 14, right after that, it says, because straight is the gate, narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few be that find it. He's just speaking about asking for the power of the Holy Spirit. He's just speaking about this. And now he turns and he says, okay, I hope you follow me here. He's speaking about we ask, we seek, and we knock. All right? Then after that, he gives this reference. And I believe this reference is saying that many people don't get this far. Because straight is the gate, narrow the way, which leadeth unto life, few be that find it. I do not believe this is speaking about salvation. He's speaking about the power of the Holy Spirit. He's just finished saying, ask, seek, and knock. And you know right where you're at in that position. If you're asking, you're over here. If you're seeking, you're looking. If you're knocking, you're right at the door. See? You don't knock where you seek. Yeah? You don't knock where you ask. You knock when you're at the door. And the Bible talks about this in Revelation, that if we knock, he will hear. He will open the door and come and communicate or sup with us. So I want to take a look at this. Within the tabernacle, there were three active places of service in the holy place. Number one, there was fire in the holy place. Okay, now after the consecration offering, now they were allowed. Only then were they allowed to go into the holy place. And I believe this is the thing of, this will we do if God permit. That unless the consecration of your life, your future, your past, and everything has met this condition, God will not take you further. Because this is a condition that has to be met. And that is to undo yourself and let God do you. The Levites no more looked like a Levite. In fact, the priest now wears a different thing on his head that says, "Holiness unto the Lord." He looked like a total different person. He was no more identified with the Levites or even with the children of Israel. He didn't look like any of them anymore, but he was identified as the priest of the Most High God. Now he had priestly garments, and only priestly garments you can get into this place. You see the difference? And this is where many people don't want to go further. They value what they are. We value our chaff too much. There's this certain protection. Well, what if I, you see? Now, some people take chaff and whatever you take, just throw it to the wind. It's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a serious person that is seeking after God, laying things down and sacrificing it unto the Lord, as I do not need this anymore, and I'm willing to suffer wherever I'm asked to suffer. I will do whatever you ask me, Lord. I'm willing to go through the most difficult times in my life, and I will just bear it because it is you that will lead me. It is an unbetrayable trust that you give in God, not in yourself or in anything you are or where you've come from. This is consecration. What happened then is they put oil on this person. They anointed him with oil. It's talking about Moses' beard, you know that oil? This is where all these things happen. They had to wash them. There's a whole process. But now they could enter that place. Now, when they're entering into a place, I want you to see this. This is actually kind of the thing that our daily activity in the temple, in the tabernacle, in the holy place. Now, remember, we have been dealt with. We've given our life over to God. He now has allowing us to come in right next to the veil. The veil was still in place. And I hear people say like this, "Now, yes, now the veil is rent. We can all get in." No. Wait a minute. What about the door? The veil was not the door. That door was outside. The veil was inside. It was the separation between the holy place and the holy of holies, not the outer court. That door was never put away. That door still stands. And I believe Jesus is that door. The Bible says so. I am the door. If any man come unto me or pass by, there are some that come in some other way, the Bible says. So what does this look like? Inside the holy place. Let's take a fresh look at it. First of all, they got their direction. Why? Because it was the seven golden candlesticks. In Revelation, we read about the seven spirits of God. I believe it's the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is what was glowing from olive oil in the holy place. Fire. And fire is what gives you direction. The next thing was bread that was placed on the showbread table. It was continual bread. It was showbread. They had to replace it every week. New bread, take the old and eat it. They could eat that bread once it served its purpose and have it new again. Now we look at this picture and we see again fire with the bread. You will not make, you can take dough and you can knead it. You can do everything you can, put it in its pan, take it out and put it on right on here. And if you put half of it, it'll go right down through here. It is not able to stand on its own feet, in so words. But once it goes through the fire, you can have it stick out over the side. It won't go down. It becomes The form that it has been placed in Jesus is that form. And that only happens when it goes through the fire. So we notice that even the courage and the strength and the eating that happened in this place came as a result of fire. And we notice also there was another step that was right in front of the veil. And that was a small altar that they burned incense on. And that was their worship. So the activity inside this place, people, Christians, has to do with fire. Don't ever think that because you come to Jesus and because you come to Him, you're going through some hard times and you cry to God, you cry to God, you cry in tears. It's hard, it's difficult, it's fire. The relationship between us and Almighty God is a relationship of fire. You hear me? It's a relationship of fire. It's why we go through difficult times. We go through hard times. We go through misunderstood times. We go through times that we don't have any understanding of. And it's a relationship of fire. Inside where God's truth was, next to Himself, where the veil was rent then, inside that place was a fire relationship. Don't think that you've gone way wrong or have gone way out on the side when you have to approach Him in a fiery manner, when you have to seek Him with all your heart, crying out to Him, God, I need a change in my life. God, I'm the old, same old person I've always was. God, I need a change. It's a fiery relationship. And He speaks by fire, the 7 golden candlesticks. And then our will, which is the type of the bread. And then our worship. It's fiery. Can you now see a picture why the lukewarm don't satisfy Jesus? Why He speaks to the lukewarm? I'd rather not have them. I'd rather have them cold. Fire. Baptized with fire. And that fire all happens in that holy place. This is the realm we walk in. Yeah? Don't ever get tired of fire. That's the relationship. This is where we get our direction. This is where we get our strength. This is where worship comes from. This is the believer's life. Do you hear me? So easy to complain about our trials, and I've embarrassed myself many times and ashamed of things I've complained about. God's dealing with me. God's working in me, dealing with me. Diminishing me down to, you know, there's only a small part. When you start refining work on a diamond and some of the precious stones that are out there, do you know most of them lose like even up to 80% of its weight just by shaping them and shaping them to where they are, the maximum value. And here when we lose 10% of ourselves, we cry and wail and think it's horrible. But when we look at the picture of what God is doing, let us therefore go on unto perfection. This is what we're talking about. How perfect do you want God to make you? How far do you want to go in God's perfection? You go as far as His voice leads you, where He calls you, the desire to go deeper with Him. I have to leave that and we'll go to final things. We want some worship at the end. If something like this could be arranged, something that might, I don't know, fire the Holy Spirit. Let's just look at some more things about fire. Revelation chapter 4, verse 5. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunders and voices, and there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. This is right now going on in heaven. There's fire. Leviticus 9:24, and there came a fire out before the Lord and consumed upon the altar the burnt offering and the fat, which when all people saw, They shouted and fell on their faces. The fire shall be, and then it talks about the fire. The fire came out from before the Lord. And then Leviticus chapter 6, 13. And the fire shall be an ever burning upon the altar. It shall never go out. There's always a fire relationship that we have with God. I really want you to hear that. I really want you to hear that. It's a fire relationship. When God spoke, many times He used fire. When He gets the most of our cries, it's when we go through the fire. There's a fire picture here. And where there's fire, there's almost always something becoming less. Something becoming less. You can have an oil full of, like these lamps up here. Do you notice that they come up here every so often and put more oil in there? Why? They put olive oil in there because the fire is burning it away. So where there's fire, there's something diminishing. It's a fire relationship. Leviticus chapter 6, verse 13, and the fire shall be, I just read that, ever be burning upon the altar, it shall never go out. Numbers chapter 9, cloud in the day, fire in the night, and it's guidance through fire. Malachi 3, verse 2, but who may abide the day of His coming? Talking about Jesus. And who shall stand when He appeareth? For He shall be like a refiner's fire and a fuller's soap. There is again. When Jesus will come, He will be like a refiner's fire. Do you have Jesus in your life? Is He doing this? There's a refining. It's a continual processing. And it has to do with us dying. And no more complaining. See, if we're a complainer, God will deal with that too. And then the complaining will come out until that gets diminished, until the fire puts that out. Excuses. I could be a really good Christian if it wouldn't be for my neighbor, wouldn't be for my job, wouldn't be for my... Let God diminish that through the refining process. If you say you're baptized with the Holy Spirit and complain about the fire, you're complaining about the whole package that comes with the Holy Spirit. It's just the way it works. Exemplified over and over in the Bible. This is how it works. Going deeper with God. Who may abide the day of His coming? And in verse 3, He shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. How is refining done and purifying done? Through fire. Exodus 3, verse 2, and the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. When God talked to Moses at the end of 40 years, being in a lonely place, being in a seemed like a God-forsaken place, it was like, God, is there ever any hope for me anymore? Then God spoke, but how did He speak? From fire. He spoke out of a bush, but it was through fire. Through fire. Exodus 19, 18, and the Mount Sinai was altogether on smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire, and the smoke thereof ascended to the smoke as the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mount quaked greatly. Is this some of that smoke? You see the difference? I might not be on video here. It's okay. I'll walk down the center. Is this part of that smoke? When God actually visited Mount Sinai. Backside. Smoke. It says smoke descended to the heavens. Smoke. I'm touching it. Smoke. Smoke. When God spoke through fire. And you can rub it off. I did right here. You say, why doesn't it rub off over there? Because it doesn't rain there. There's no rain. Just seemingly it doesn't rain. Backside, front side. This was like this. Broke. We marvel at this little tool, don't we? Thousands of years ago. Hallelujah. People, can you thank God for fire? It's his means of communication. It's his means of communication. It's his means of refinement. As you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Fire, Holy Spirit. Fire, Holy Spirit. Can't separate them. So like Leonard Ravenhill said, many people want to be empowered. How was that, Martha? You just read it to me the other day. Many people want the power of the Holy Spirit, but they do not want to diminish the old man. We don't want to lose our old man, but we want to have that old man empowered. It doesn't work that way. There's dying, and then there's living. There's dying, and then there's resurrection. If the worship team would come, I'm almost finished. For our God is a consuming fire. Hebrews 12:29. 2 Peter 3:10, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. How? With fire. God and fire cannot separate them. Revelation 21:8, but the fearful and unbelieving and abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall all have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. God will destroy all the wickedness by fire. God will destroy the wickedness in us, I believe, by fire. Through testings and fire, he uses fire. God is the one that made fire. God is the one that developed fire. God is the one that made fire work. Isaiah 4:4, when the Lord shall have washed away the filth of the daughters of Zion, he shall have purged the blood of Jerusalem from the midst thereof by the spirit of judgment and the spirit of burning. Isaiah. All these activities are by way of fire. In 1 Chronicles 6:27, the glory and honor are in his presence. Strength and gladness are in his place. Many valuable stones, I did the translating to a better understanding. Many valuable stones lose as much as 60% of their initial size, mass, before they are considered finished as beautiful jewels. We must sacrifice significant parts of our lives, our habits, our cultures, our reasonings, our personal values, and even comfort zones if you want God to take you further. About 1,000 years ago, after God, through his power of the Holy Spirit, left the temple, he came to the upper room. When those wheels were turning and the sadness overtook the temple and the glory left, and people were no more excited, there was really nothing to go back to. There was a form of it, but there was no glory there anymore. Let us be careful that we don't go back to the old temple when there is no glory anymore. Let's allow God to have his glory within our hearts. Let's not go back to the old forms. Maybe years ago I used to so-and-so, now we excuse ourselves as, well, yeah, but There's no glory there anymore. What's the problem when the glory leaves? It was jealousy and idolatry. And God said, I cannot dwell there. I will go somewhere else. And then he stood over the Mount of Olives waiting for all of us. For over 1,000 years later, now 3,000 years later, for that glory to come into our temple. Are you filled with the glory of God? Are you understanding the workings of God? Your problem is not your neighbor. The problem is God is dealing with you. And sometimes God deals with you based on a prayer you prayed when you were really young. God, use me. What does that look like? He comes to the upper room. How did he come? By fire. Tongues of fire. It's a beautiful picture. How do I release the content that God has placed in me? It is done through fire. You know the name of it? It's called sacrifice. That's something that in the Old Testament, it was just an everyday event thing of sacrifice, sacrifice, sacrifice. We as God's children do the same thing. It doesn't have to go my way. It doesn't have to go your way. What does sacrifice look like in your life? What does it look like in your life? Some people interpret it as being something where you just go and get rid of everything. No, sometimes it's not that. I think we all have done that, or we should have laid everything down, our jobs, our everything, so it can be established in Him. Let Him raise it up. But what does sacrifice look like in your life? So I'm not giving in, I'm not giving up, it's my way, it's... There's no fire in that. Maybe God will meet you again when you open that in your life and the fire of God will come and start burning up burning. Amen? You know, trials are difficult. We don't like them. I don't like them. But if I can go through a trial so that I can be diminished, and more diminished and more diminished, that somehow he can get his glory, then it's for him and not for me, for him and not for us. And my thing is, there's something about putting an unbetrayable trust in the hands of God and saying, God, I'm yours. I will not discourage in this. I will go on. We meet his conditions. Listen to his conditions. He will woo you with them. You'll know his conditions. There's some things you might have to totally give up. I would rather say you have to give up everything. And sometimes we in our selfish ways think that if we give up something, God will rip it from us. No, just give it up. Lay it down. If he wants to take it, then it's up to him. I remember when God dealt with me and my children, lay down my children. I knew the next day there was probably going to be a big accident. They're going to... Yeah, I'll die. No, it wasn't that way, but I gave him up. I know I did. When you give it up, it becomes the Lord's. And there is no safer place for it than having heaven's angels protecting what you have when it's no more you having to do that. It's the safest place. It's fire insurance. It's accidental insurance. It's future insurance. It's eternal insurance. It's all of this. Just give it up for God. Lay it all down. Amen. God bless you. We'll have worship. John, I forgot how that was stated. Will you close the service or what? Steve will close the service. All right. And we welcome you, Brother Steve Yonellen, back from beautiful Switzerland. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you.
minute or so yet for several.
It's good to be here today. Thank you, Brother Wayne, for the message. And my mind went back over many years. And I thought about a verse that Brother Wayne quoted. I remember when this verse entered my heart in Hebrews chapter 12. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, it's sure, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and with godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. So he is. The fire of God. And sometimes in closing a service, you know, we don't know sometimes exactly how to do that. But I know our God is a consuming fire. He's powerful. And I think in closing, I want to say this, that there is a deeper place, and this is what Brother Wayne was ministering to us today. There is a deeper walk with God. And if you're not there, begin to ask, begin to seek. There's a place where the power of God is real in our lives and effective, not just something that we hear about. The other thing that I have come to know and understand is there are no shortcuts in the Christian life. And the Bible says that very clearly. God says, I will not be mocked. And I find, in going back into my life, there have been times when I've tried to find another way around. And the Bible speaks about those who try to come in a window or over a wall. But there are no shortcuts. The price has to be paid. Now, we know that Jesus paid the price for our salvation. But to go deeper with God, your life has to be put onto the altar. And there is no shortcut from that. There's no other way around. But it's a very small cost. Because it is things that will disappear anyway and will become burned up at some place, at some point in time. The power of God, the fire of God. And I've found so true what Brother Wayne ministered today out of the Word of God. But you know what the fire of God does? It does what it did to the three Hebrew children in the fire. They were bound and thrown in the fire because they stood in faith. And then the king stood up and he said, hey, I see another one in there. And it looks like the Son of God, and they burned the bonds that were around their arms and their legs, and they were walking around in the fire. And when the fire of God comes in our life, it burns, and it takes away things that we don't need, but it frees us. It frees us from the self-life that wants to bind us. Don't be afraid to lay things on the altar. You'll find freedom. And I don't know, I don't believe that process ever entirely stops as long as we live in this life. But we become to understand it in a way, I believe I could say that. And then the Lord surprises us with something that we thought was dealt with. Maybe in a deeper way, he asks us now lay it down again. Hallelujah. Bless God for the power of God. Thank you, Brother Wayne, for the message. And it's good to be back. My wife and I were gone for 2 Sundays, and we had a wonderful time in Switzerland and Austria and Germany, just doing some traveling with my wife's brothers. So that was good. But it's good to be back here. Lord has made a wonderful, wonderful world or earth, But it is nothing compared to the glories that are awaiting us, is it? But it is good to see. So stand with me and I'll have a closing prayer. Father, I thank you for the word that was brought forth today to us. And I thank you. And Lord, even as I stand here, there's an awe and respect. You're a consuming fire. How is it that we as human beings can approach you, holy in your being? Only through Christ, the door. By his blood, through your mercy, can we come. And you change our lives and you burn away the things that sometimes we think are so necessary and yet keep us from finding freedom and power. Lord, thank you. Thank you for how you deal with us. Thank you for your fire. Thank you that you are fire. And that you burn. Burn away everything, Lord, so that one day when the fire comes, we will not be found with things that are wood, hay, or stubble, but truly with things that are gold, silver, precious stones that are only refined by fire and not burned up. But the true precious things of the Spirit, of your kingdom, may they be developed and refined deeper and deeper, or more and more in our lives. And in this church here, Lord, our hearts are at times burdened because of conditions around us, but may your fire again consume so that we become effective in the places where we're at, where it's at work or wherever we go, that your strength and your power comes forth from us to be a light and a glory to your name. Lord, as we go from this place now, I'm sure there's different needs in our lives, and Lord, but you are the I am. You are the I am for healing. You are the I am for finances. You are the I am for relationships. And I pray, Lord, wherever a need is, may your presence come there and your Spirit move there. In greater and deeper ways. We bless you and thank you, Lord. Be now with the people as we leave this place. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be dismissed. Keep your eyes on the Lord, for he is on the throne. Whatever struggle you're in, give it to him. Bless him continually. You're dismissed.